Right?
All right, good morning, everyone. Welcome to First Church of the Nazarene. Let's stand as we begin our worship this morning with Friend of God.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see you this morning. It's good to be able to be together and worship together as we come. This morning as we gather, let's begin with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your love for us and for the privilege that we have of gathering in this place today. Thank you for a couple of dry days and continue to pray for those who are working overtime, trying to keep our city safe and trying to deal with the effects of this flooding. Just pray for your hand to be upon them and protect them and strengthen them and encourage them. Father, we know that each one of us today comes into this place with a different type of stressor, a different type of challenge, a different thing that we're facing. And as we come into this place, I pray that you will surround us with your peace, that you would speak your hope into our hearts and help us to see you, and that we may see our troubles differently as we spend our time together today. Father, we thank you for inviting us to gather together and for meeting with us. In Jesus' name, amen.
And you may be seated.
Well, a couple of announcements as we get started today. First of all, we will have our PM service tonight at 6 o'clock. And we won't next week because it's Mother's Day. So we will look ahead next week, the middle of next week, not this coming week. The next week we'll be starting the book of Galatians. And so we'll look ahead to that tonight. Our next food pantry is this Thursday. So if you're available to help with the food pantry, the details are in the bulletin on that. There's a sign-up sheet in the foyer. This is a great opportunity for us to serve our community and to serve our neighbors. So if you would like to volunteer to help with that, please sign up in the foyer. If you have any questions, you can see Mary.
All right. I think it just went out, didn't it? Yeah, it went
out. Is my microphone? Yeah, it's coming and going. All right. May 19th will be our annual church elections for those night, and that will be during the morning service. Well, our picture in the background this morning as we worship, Chad, if you can take the text off of there. Monday evening, I went downtown and took some pictures of the flooding. This was before the barrier broke. You can see, you may be able to see, there are cars parked right here that now would not be able to be parked there. But I want us to keep in mind a couple of things as we worship this morning. First of all, keep in prayer those who are fighting this flooding and those who are trying to figure out what's life going to be like, the new normal that people are facing, business owners, etc., that have their lives work underwater at the moment. But I also want us to understand that sometimes it feels like our lives are underwater. And a part of what Paul is dealing with in 2 Corinthians as we continue this journey through this letter is just that sense of when you feel like life is underwater and you may feel like there's no hope, God is speaking hope into our lives. And so as we worship today, I want this picture up here for two reasons. Again, I want us to be praying as we worship for those whose lives are impacted by this flooding. But I also want us to be reminded that even at times when we feel like our lives are underwater, God is giving hope. I saw last night on the news, one of the meteorologists, somebody had submitted a similar picture, and he said it's this bittersweet picture because you have this gorgeous sunset, and then down below you have all this destruction. And sometimes that's how our lives feel. There's this beautiful thing happening, and yet there's this horrific thing happening at the same time. And as we worship, let's invite God into those painful areas of our lives. Let's stand together as we continue to worship. Blessed be your name.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You know, we have an awesome privilege as Christians of being able to bring our requests to God and to know that He wants to hear us. It's an amazing thing. It's something that for us is confusing because we're used to living in a world where people only want to hear from important people. Or we constantly feel shut down like, oh, they don't want to hear from me. They don't want to hear me say anything. But the beautiful thing is we serve a God who not only created us and cares for us, but He wants to hear from us. In the times of our trouble, in the times of our struggles, He wants to hear from us. And so we have this part of our service, a dedicated time where we bring our requests before God. And it doesn't matter how simple the request may seem. It doesn't matter how overwhelming the request may seem, but He wants to hear from us. And so we're going to sing through this chorus again, and then we'll take some time to pray. And I just encourage you to take advantage of this opportunity to cry out to God. Heavenly Father, we thank You for the privilege that we have of coming before You this morning. The privilege of bringing our requests to You and knowing that You care, knowing that You hear us. And Father, this morning as we come into this time and come into this place, I know we come carrying a lot of heavy burdens. We think of the city of Davenport and the victims of the floods for Moline and Rock Island as well, and Bettendorf, all of the areas being impacted by this flood and all of those downriver that are getting ready to get it. Father, we think of those who are fighting the flood and those who have put in 12-hour days, 7 days a week for the last month. We pray for Your strength for them. Father, there are a lot of needs, and situations like this remind us that we're not in control of as much as we think we are. And so we bring these who are struggling and facing the impacts of flooding to You. And for those who are experiencing other impacts from the rain, those who have had water in their houses and trying to fight those battles as well. Again, Father, we know that these times remind us that we don't control as much as we think we control. And there are a lot of other situations that we face, many of us facing health situations that we wish we could understand or we wish we could just fix, but that seem to be beyond our control. And we lift those up to You who are struggling with health concerns. We lift those up who are struggling with the realities of grief. Those who are struggling in the realities of relationships that are not what they should be. And Father, in all of these situations, we just ask that You would be at work and that You would help us to see Your hand at work. Lord, there are a lot of times in our life, a lot of places in our lives that are hurt and broken. There are a lot of situations that we want so desperately to fix, but we just feel like we can't. There are a lot of pains in this world. And we take a few moments now just to silently lift up those pains and those concerns in our lives in a moment of silent prayer. Father, thank you that you hear us when we pray. Thank you that you're aware of our situations and you are here for us in the midst of them. Thank you for your love and your grace, your forgiveness and your peace that you offer as gifts to us. Help us to receive those gifts from you today. And Father, at times when we don't exactly know what to say, we find great strength and great comfort in praying together the prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And you may be seated. Ushers will come forward at this time. We'll continue to worship through the giving of our tithes and offerings. Mike, would you pray for our offering this morning?
Lord, thank you for being with us in your Holy Spirit and our fellowship together. Thank you for your love, grace, mercy, blessings, and guidance, and for all that you do for everyone in this world every day in every way. Please bless our offering today, for all power, honor, praise, and glory is yours forever. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Till the storm passes by.
right, thank you to our worship this morning. Well, as we were on the Sky Bridge on Monday night, there was one panel of glass that was broken. And it was interesting to look through that panel of glass because the view feels very different. And that's what this picture is behind us, is that the flooding, you can kind of see some, that's River Drive right there. And yet it's looking through a broken window. Doesn't look quite the same, does it? And that's oftentimes how life feels to us. We're approaching life not as the situation is in the moment, but we're approaching life through the broken glasses that we have on. And that's what Paul is wrestling with in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Now, we're on this journey through the letters of Paul, and this journey has been interesting. With Paul, he wrote his letters, he wrote a total of 13 letters that are a part of the New Testament. And this quarter, we're working very quickly through six of them. We're not going through them in chronological order. Instead, we're reading through the order that they appear in the New Testament. And in case you're wondering what made that order what it is, has nothing to do with the importance, has nothing to do when it was written, it has to do with their length. So Romans was first, it's just slightly longer than 1 Corinthians, and then 1 Corinthians, and then 2 Corinthians, and then Galatians, Ephesians, Colossians. It's all about the length of the letter, not about the importance of it. And it's not chronological, which creates a little bit of a challenge for us as we're breezing through these six letters, all of which were written within about 2 years of one another. But very different circumstances happened that informs why each letter was written when it was. Now, the Corinthian church, the recipients of this letter, this was a church that Paul started on his second missionary journey. And he stayed in Corinth longer than he'd stayed anywhere up to that point in time. He stayed between a year and a half and 2 years, which for Paul, who usually on his missionary journeys started a riot and got kicked out of town within a few days, weeks, or months, depending on which city he's in, this is a pretty big deal for him to be able to stay in one place for up to 18 months. And he was very proud of starting this church in what in that culture was known as Sin City. Now, Corinth made Vegas look tame. Corinth was one of those cities that if it could be imagined in perversion, it could be done in Corinth. And Corinth prided itself in its perversion, in its worship of the gods of sin. It's the best way that I can put it. The highest point in Corinth was a temple to the goddess Aphrodite. So no matter where you're at in Corinth, you look up and there's that temple. It's up on a mountain behind the city. No matter where you're at, you can look up and see this temple. And you don't really have to look up because the temple employed over 1,000 temple prostitutes who were roaming the streets. So everywhere you looked, you saw that sin. And Paul was pretty proud of himself because in the midst of this sin, he'd planted a church. He watched as that church grew. And he felt pretty good about it. But as soon as Paul left Corinth, things got a little bit crazy. Apollos, who was another preacher of that era, we don't know where he came from other than he's from the city of Alexandria. We don't know Alexandria. We don't know how he came to know the gospel, but he did, and he shows up and he starts preaching. And truthfully, he was a better preacher than Paul was. He was more polished. He was more eloquent in the way that he spoke. And so the people who had been there when Paul started the church, and they look back on that time and they're like, well, you know what? Paul may have started this church, but he wasn't a very good preacher. Apollos, now he's a preacher. And then the Apostle Peter most likely showed up, according to what we read in 1 Corinthians. And he was with the Lord the entire time of his earthly ministry. In fact, he was the apostle that first proclaimed that Jesus was the Messiah. He's a pretty important guy. He's more of an apostle than Paul. And so the church, after visits by Apollos and most likely by Peter, begins to reject Paul. And so Paul writes a series of letters. What we have as 1 Corinthians was actually his second letter. We don't have the first letter. He wrote this letter of 1 Corinthians, and he starts out this letter by saying, "Why are you so divided? Why are some of you saying that you follow Paul, and some are you saying you follow Apollos, and some are you saying you follow Peter?" And we don't know if they were saying it or if Paul's saying it, but he's like, "And some of you just follow Jesus. What are you talking about? This is not the gospel. I didn't preach to you a divided gospel." And then we have 2 Corinthians, which was actually the fourth letter that Paul wrote. There was one in between what we know as 1 Corinthians and what we know as 2 Corinthians. Paul calls it his tearful letter. It's a letter that he wrote, and it was kind of a mean letter. And we don't have it, probably because the church in Corinth decided to burn it after they read it. But we have 1 Corinthians, which is 2nd, and 2 Corinthians, which is 4th. You following the math here? And we're only seeing half the conversation. You've been in the room with somebody, and they're on the phone, and you hear what they're saying, but you don't know who they're talking to or what they're talking about. You just hear half of this conversation, and you're trying to make sense of it. And that's what we're doing here with these letters. We're seeing half of the conversation. We don't know what the Corinthians are saying to Paul. We just know what Paul is saying to them. And we only have half of the side that we do see. So they went into the other room because they didn't want us listening in to part of it. And then they came back into the room so that we could hear part of it. But we have to piece together some of what they were facing after only hearing a brief part of, only half of the conversation, and only half of what we are hearing half of. Does that make sense? Clear as mud? In between the second and third letters, so in between what we know as 1 Corinthians and the tearful letter, Paul decides, "I'm just going to solve this whole thing, and I'm going to go back to Corinth." And he made a surprise visit. And his visit did not go well. He shows up thinking, as soon as I walk in the room, they're just going to say, "You know what? It's the Apostle Paul. Here's the guy who planted our church. Here's the guy who got us started. We're so sorry. What were we thinking?" Except that didn't go that way. Paul walks into the room, and people stand up against him. We don't know what they were fighting over. That's a part of the letters that we don't have. We don't know who it was that stood up against him. We just know somebody stood up against him. And Paul, as arrogant as he could be, knew in that moment that if he stayed to fight, he would diminish the point of the gospel. And so he gets on a boat and he heads back over to Ephesus with everything unresolved. And this church that he was so proud of, that he invested so much in, has now turned against him. And it's not just that they've turned against him. It's not just his ego that's at stake. But they've confused the gospel message. And now they're believing this messed up version of Christianity that Paul would say was no Christianity at all. Paul was devastated, understandably, by what was happening. And he gets back to Ephesus, where he's stationed at this time. And things had been going phenomenally for Paul in Ephesus up to this point. The book of Acts tells us that when Paul got to Ephesus, everything that could go well went well. People were excited to hear this gospel message. People were following him. He could just touch a piece of cloth and somebody else touch that piece of cloth and they would be healed. Now, it doesn't say that that happened anywhere else, but in Ephesus, that was happening. And in Ephesus, Paul had a crowd that gathered and he had to rent this big hall to speak in. And in Ephesus, even the pagans were using Paul's name when they were trying to exorcise demons. And in Ephesus, which was a center of black magic in the Roman world, a bunch of the magicians said, this Paul, he's got more than what we've got. We want this God, not our magic. And they brought their magic books and they burnt them. If you can imagine, Paul probably has his name in lights. The Apostle Paul preaching here tonight. My first Sunday in McCook, they had a church sign that had the pastor's name on it. And so I took a picture the first week that I was there with Pastor Emmanuel. And I said, take that sign off because nobody cares if I'm the pastor. They don't know who I am anyway. And when I got here, I think that was a question. Do you want your name on the sign? It's like, no. People are going to walk by and see the sign, or drive by and see the sign. It's like, oh, Pastor Emmanuel, who's that? Paul had his name in lights. The Apostle Paul. Everything was going well until it wasn't. And then everything at once caved in on the Apostle Paul. Everything in Corinth that he had taken so much pride in absolutely collapsed. And now the church was not just turning against him, but they were turning against the truths of the gospel. And he gets this riot started because people have stopped buying idols. In Corinth, the biggest god was Aphrodite, as I've already said, but in Ephesus it was Artemis. And people had stopped buying idols to Artemis. And the silversmiths got mad because their business was down, their profits were down, and they were trying to figure out, why aren't people buying as many idols? The Apostle Paul is preaching here tonight. And so they go out into the streets and they say, hey, we got to get this going. A guy named Demetrius leads the charge. And he says, we've got to protect our income. So let's get the people riled up by saying we've got to protect Ephesus. And so they get this riot started where thousands of people are in the streets, and then they go into the amphitheater there in Ephesus, which seats many, many people. And they're all shouting at the top of their lungs, great is Artemis of the Ephesians. Great is Artemis of the Ephesians. For hours, they're just yelling this. And they don't even know why they're saying this, other than they're from Ephesus and somebody said, we got to say this. Eventually, the local magistrate gets things quieted down enough that he can speak. And he says, guys, stop it. If Rome finds out that you're rioting, they're going to send people to ask for my head. And I don't even know why you're rioting, because you don't even know why you're rioting. And then somebody said, well, it's because of this Paul and what he's preaching. And the magistrate said, if Demetrius has got a beef with Paul, he can take it to the courts. Don't take it to the streets, because we're going to get in trouble with Rome. And it appears that Demetrius did take it to the courts. Because the message that Paul was preaching, Rome did not believe in freedom of religion. Rome had one main religion and then about 1,000 other religions that fed into that. The one main religion was the worship of the emperor. And Ephesus not only had this massive temple to Artemis, but they also had this massive temple freshly built, to the emperor. And what Paul was telling people, what the gospel message says, is that there is one God. We worship Him. We worship Him as He is, has come among us in the form of Jesus Christ. We worship a Trinitarian God. We do not worship Caesar. We do not worship Artemis. We do not worship, list off all of the other Roman gods or Greek gods. Most of the gods had two names because they had their Roman name and their Greek god, their Greek name. We don't worship any of those. We worship God the Father and His Son Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. And that was illegal. It was illegal in Ephesus to worship any god other than Caesar. Now, the Jews had an exemption. Julius Caesar, when he first allowed people to worship him, realized that the Jews were not going to worship him, and so he offered this exemption for the Jews, that they could avoid the worship of Caesar as long as they prayed to their god for Caesar. It was a Jewish-only exemption. And Paul was preaching this message not just to the Jews, that Jesus Christ was the Messiah, but to Gentiles who previously had frequented the temple of Caesar, because everybody had to. And now they were, Paul was teaching them to break the law, and apparently Paul gets thrown in prison. And this is a tough time for Paul. It's not his first time in prison. We know that he was in prison in Philippi briefly. They beat him, they threw him in prison, and then found out that they shouldn't have because he had papers that proved he was a Roman citizen, which said you couldn't do that, and he got out of jail. We don't have the specific details about this imprisonment in Ephesus, but it wasn't brief. And Paul tells us at the beginning of 2 Corinthians that he didn't think he was going to make it. He thought he was going to die, and he reached the end of himself. And he wrote several letters during this time of being in prison. He wrote the book of Philippians, probably earlier on in this imprisonment, because in the book of Philippians, he tells us, I don't know if I'm going to live or if I'm going to die. I don't know if I'm going to make it out of these chains or if I'm going to die here. And then we see Colossians, Ephesians, Philemon, which were written at the same time. And they all kind of indicate, I think I'm going to get off from here. I think I'm going to get out. But he wrote these four letters while imprisoned. And eventually he gets out of prison. We don't know how. We don't know what happened. We don't even know what the original charges were. But he gets out of prison. He writes to the Corinthians this tearful letter, this mean letter that says, you better come into line. And we don't know what he said because they probably burned it. And then he waits for a response. You know, sometimes we'll send a text to somebody and we'll, it's kind of a text that may be asking for a favor. It's a text that may be saying, hey, I'm interested in this. Could you help me with this? And then they don't respond. And they don't respond. And you're just sitting there watching your phone. You shake it. Waiting for this text. Paul didn't have texts. He sent this letter via foot through a friend named Titus. And depending on the time of year when he sent this letter, you could either shoot across the Aegean Sea to get from Ephesus to Corinth, or if it was the wrong time of year to take a boat, you had to hoof it. From Ephesus up, across a very short passage of the sea, over in from Asia into Europe, into Macedonia, and then hoof it all the way down. And then they had to come all the way back. And Paul waited, and he waited. And he waited. He did not know if this church in Corinth was going to receive him again. He didn't know if they were furious with him. And he wrote this letter of 2 Corinthians, which is his fourth letter, while he's on the way to him. It starts and it stops. It starts and it stops. Translators say this is the worst letter of Paul to translate because he'll get started on something and then he stops. It's like he's walking for a while and he's thinking and then he stops and he has his scribe write it down, or he wrote it down, and then he started off again and then he has him write something else down. There's not a whole lot of clear thought from beginning to end of this letter. There's a whole bunch of little passages that you almost think, well, that doesn't fit with what you just said, but it's because he's writing it most likely on his way. In the first part of the letter, he tells them, as he's traveling, the tough time that he faced. He continues to try to prove himself to the Corinthians. He's trying to explain to them who he is and why they should accept him as their spiritual father, as the apostle who planted their church. And he tries to explain to them the truth of who he is. And I want us to read one section of this explanation. And there's probably three different sections in what we read this last week in 2 Corinthians where he's trying to make this same argument. But we're going to read this from 2 Corinthians chapter 4. So if you have your Bibles or you want to follow along in the app, we're going to start reading in verse 1 of chapter 4, 2 Corinthians. Therefore, since God in his mercy has given us this new way, we never give up. We reject all shameful deeds and underhanded methods. We don't try to trick anyone or distort the words of God. We tell the truth before God, and all who are honest know this. If the good news we preach is hidden behind a veil, it is hidden only from people who are perishing. Satan, who is the god of this world, has blinded the minds of those who don't believe, and they're unable to see the glorious light of the good news. They don't understand this message about the glory of Christ, who is the exact likeness of God. You see, we don't go around preaching about ourselves. We preach that Jesus Christ is Lord, and we ourselves are your servants for Jesus' sake. Do you get what he's saying there? This isn't about me. This is about the truth of the gospel. I'm not here to tell you who I am so that you'll say, oh, Paul's amazing. I'm here to tell you who Jesus is, because the truth is that Jesus is amazing. And he says this. He says, for God, who said, let there be light in the darkness, has made this light shine in our hearts so that we could know the glory of God that is seen in the face of Jesus Christ. We now have this light shining in our hearts, but we ourselves are like fragile clay jars containing this great treasure. This makes it clear that our great power is from God, not from ourselves. We are pressed on every side by troubles, but we are not crushed. We are perplexed, but not driven to despair. We are hunted down, but never abandoned by God. We get knocked down, but we are not destroyed. Through suffering, our bodies continue to share in the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be seen in our bodies. Yes, we live under constant danger of death because we serve Jesus, so the life of Jesus will be evident in our dying bodies. So we live in the face of death, but this has resulted in eternal life for you. But we continue to preach because we have the same kind of faith the psalmist had when he said, I believe in God, so I spoke. We know that God who raised the Lord Jesus will also raise us with Jesus and present us to himself together with you. And all of this is for your benefit. And as God's grace reaches more and more people, there will be great thanksgiving and God will receive more and more glory. And I want you to pay attention to what he says next. This is why we never give up. Though our bodies are dying, our spirits are being renewed every day. For our present troubles are small and won't last very long. Yet they produce for us a glory that vastly outweighs them and will last forever. So we don't look at the troubles we can see now. Rather, we fix our gaze on things that cannot be seen. The things we see now will soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever. There's an awful lot in what Paul says there. And I've wrestled all week with trying to figure out, okay, there's like 50 sermons in what we read this week. There's so many things that could be said. And I tried to squeeze as many of them in as I could. Until finally last night, I just felt like the Lord said to me, man, you're not supposed to talk about all of them. Focus in here. Paul starts off by saying he's not trying to trick them. Chapter 3, I think it was, or chapter 2, he's like, we're not hucksters. We're not out here to try to trick you or manipulate you. He said, we did not act in any shameful or underhanded way. We simply told the truth. We're not trying to twist it and make you believe something that we're not that is not the gospel message. He said, I'm not even here preaching myself. I don't want your church to be called St. Paul's Church of Corinth. I want your church to be called the Church of Jesus Christ. I'm not here to get my name on the wall. I just want you to know who Jesus Christ is. That was Paul's message. And then he transitions into this series. He references God saying, let there be light in the darkness. That's how the book of Genesis starts. It talks about how the Lord spoke and there was light in the darkness. But it's also how God first got Paul's attention. On the road to Damascus, as he was making his way to Damascus, a blinding light shone in his eyes and blinded him for 3 days. The light, Paul's telling his testimony here, but also connecting it to the beginning of Genesis, that God said, let there be light. And there was light. Let there be light in the darkness. And Paul said that God shone the light into his heart. And the light of God revealed to Paul the face of Jesus Christ. This had been what Paul was fighting against. He did not believe that Jesus Christ had anything to do with God. And yet in this light that God shone into Paul's heart, he saw the face of Jesus Christ. And then he says this, I have the light of Jesus in my heart. I have the light of Jesus in my life. But I have found myself to be a fragile clay jar. Now that's an interesting illustration, isn't it? Why would you call yourself a fragile clay jar? We don't even know what a fragile clay jar is. I mean, it's not something that we use. Today he may say something like, I'm a fragile screen on your iPhone when you drop it. Paul was traveling. And when you're traveling, you have to take your stuff with you. They didn't have fast food drive-thrus that you could just zip into. You had to carry your food with you. And some of your food, your water, some of it you could carry in containers that weren't fragile, but some of it you probably had to carry in fragile containers. And it's very possible that as Paul was traveling and he went to get his water bottle and it fell and it cracked and the water went everywhere. It may have been that God spoke to him in that moment and said, Paul, you're fragile. Don't forget it. You're a human being. Don't forget it. You're not as powerful as you think you are, Paul. Yes, I've shown my light into your heart. I want you to proclaim the message of who I am to the world, but don't forget you're human. And I think that Paul may have forgotten that. But Paul tells us here that he realizes, and it must be evident to everyone, because they are fragile clay jars. That the power that they preach is not from themselves. It's the power of God. And then Paul again reflects on his time in prison. He said, we were pressed on every side, but not crushed. We were perplexed, but not driven to despair. We were hunted down, but not abandoned by God. We were knocked down, but we were not destroyed. It's easy for us to say things like this when we're looking back. But in the midst of that imprisonment, Paul felt pressed in on every side, and he probably felt crushed. And he felt perplexed, and he told us in chapter 1 that I gave up on life. He was in despair. He was hunted down, and he probably felt abandoned by God while he was laying there in the prison with the rats and the snakes climbing over his feet. And knocked down, who knows how many times Paul got knocked down in prison. It's only in hindsight, looking back, that Paul realized that he hadn't indeed been crushed, even though he felt crushed. He hadn't indeed been in despair, because there was hope that eventually came. He hadn't been abandoned by God, even though he felt like it for a time. And he had not been destroyed, even though he felt like it. But Paul learned something in prison. It's something that he had known before. But sometimes lessons mean more to us when we're in times when we don't have anything else to cling to. And Paul learned something in his time that he shares with us. This is something that comes through in the other letters that he wrote. There's a section in Philippians chapter 2 that we'll look at in a couple of weeks. And there's a section in Colossians chapter 1 that we'll look at in a couple of weeks that beautifully illustrate what I'm about to say. But Paul learned to keep his eyes on Jesus in the midst of the mess that he was in. And this, he said, is why they never actually gave up. They felt like giving up. They felt like everything was crashing in upon them. But they kept their eyes on Jesus. He said, our bodies are dying, but our spirits are being renewed every day. I don't know what it is, but when I cross that 40-year barrier, all of a sudden I can get what Paul's saying, and I haven't been beaten nearly as many times as he has. But you just wake up some mornings and you're thinking, what's that pain from? I didn't even know that muscle was there. What did I do to aggravate that one? Paul's saying his body is dying, but his spirits were being renewed every day. And then he says this, our present troubles are small. They don't feel small, but our present troubles are small. They won't last forever, even though it feels like they're going to last forever. They produce a glory that outweighs them. What is being shaped in us, the character that is being shaped in us through the trials that we're facing, what we're learning, how we're growing, is bigger than the trial itself that we're facing. And the glory that it is developing is a glory that will indeed last forever. Paul said, we don't focus on the troubles in front of us. But we fix our gaze on what we can't see. Because what we see now will soon be gone. What we cannot yet see will last forever. I want us to think just for a moment about how this applies to the floods that we're experiencing in downtown Davenport. It feels right now like that water is never going away. What is it, day 44, 45, somewhere in that range of continual floods? Enough already. But one of the things that they've talked about, as we, especially this week, was, is this going to be bigger than the flood of 93? Which was just slightly bigger than the flood of 65. And you know what? The water wasn't in downtown Davenport from 1965 till 2019. The water's going to go down again. But it doesn't feel like it on day 45. I don't know how many of you watched the video of when the breach took place in downtown Davenport. And within 3 minutes, the breach happened and the water was up over the steps of the restaurant. This was being filmed from. Within 6 minutes. It was this deep on the wall, on the window. Those who were running to their cars probably weren't thinking, oh, this isn't going to last very long. They're thinking, is this forever? Because the water's rushing and that's all you see is what's right in front of us. But yet this is not going to last forever. So what are some lessons for us as we look at this passage? Paul learned several very important lessons during this tough time. Lessons that I think can be very helpful for us as well. First of all, hindsight 2020. Things make a lot more sense looking back than they do looking ahead. And looking back, Paul saw the hand of God. Looking back, Paul saw that even though he felt like he was being completely destroyed, he wasn't. Looking back, even though he felt like he was being completely crushed, he wasn't. Looking back, he saw the hand of God getting him through every moment in that prison, even though in the moment he felt like he would never make it out. In the middle of the trial, he didn't think he would make it. Looking back, he saw the hand of God. Sometimes, in the middle of the trials that we face, we need to be reminded that this isn't going to last forever. That the hand of God is at work in our lives, the hand of God is at work in our situations, even when we don't feel like it. And many of us today feel like we're absolutely underwater. Many of us today feel like the waves just keep coming. But we need to remember that this will not last forever. But I think we also have to remember that for Paul, the only reason that this didn't last forever is because he lived in the truth. It would have been so easy for Paul to simply say, when the officials would say to him, are you telling people not to worship Caesar? It would have been so easy for him to say, well, why would I tell them that? I love worshiping Caesar. It's the most important thing in my life. Case dismissed. Paul couldn't do that. Even though it would have been easy, even though it would have gotten him out of that situation to compromise the truth of what he believed that God had spoken to him, his only defense was genuine faith. He wasn't trying to trick or manipulate anybody. He wasn't out to get something for himself in his efforts. He had to start with the truth. I think Paul also had to remember that he was more fragile than he wanted to admit. We all reach that point, don't we? Well, you guys on the front row haven't reached it yet. You will. When you're as old as Steve, if you make it to 150, and you're hobbling around with a cane, Just making sure you're still awake over there, Steve. Paul was more fragile than he wanted to admit. His body had grown weak. He couldn't do what he once could. Used to could, that's a southern word. Can't do it anymore, but I used to could. Paul couldn't do what he used to could. He wasn't as invincible as he once thought. We're going to read a little bit later in this letter, we're going to read it this week, Paul's bragging about his weaknesses, where he's going to tell us how many times he was beaten and how many times he had been stoned, how many times he had been shipwrecked, how many times he should have died, and he just got up from every one of them. He used to think he was invincible. And yet when he was in prison, he realized, I'm not recovering from this the way that I used to. I'm more fragile than I wanted to admit. And I think for us as human beings, who happen to live in an age that doesn't acknowledge humanity, that acknowledges what we can accomplish through technology, that sometimes we just have to flat out say, I can't do what I used to be able to do. Sometimes we have to flat out say, I just don't need to do that. I don't need to do that to my body. I don't need to put myself through that. He wasn't as invincible as he once thought. But maybe the most important lesson for us is that Paul learned to fix his gaze beyond himself. Paul learned to say that what is happening right in front of me, what is happening to me right now, is not the most important thing. The most important thing is what Jesus Christ did through his death on the cross. And the hope that that brings us, that his kingdom is going to come. And this right now hurts like crazy, but it's not the point. The point is what is yet to come. The problems that we face won't last forever. The floodwaters that have inundated Davenport won't be there forever. Eventually, maybe July, but eventually those floodwaters are going to go down. But the character that they are forming in us have the potential to last forever. So some questions for us as the worship team comes. First of all, are we living in the truth? As Paul said, I'm not trying to trick you. I'm telling you the honest truth. I'm not trying to manipulate you. I'm not trying to in any way make you think something that isn't true. Are we living a genuine faith? Are we living with the truth completely, or are we compromising here and there and, well, it won't hurt anything to believe this, and it won't hurt anything to do this, and it won't. Are we living with a genuine faith? Are we living in the truth? Second question for us is, are we trying to do more than we can do? As I said, as I reach the age of 40, I'm asking these questions. How much of this stuff that I've been doing can I continue to do? What are the important things that I need to do that only I can do, and what are these things that I'm wasting energy on that somebody else could do? Or maybe things that don't even need to be done. Chanel's grandfather passed away this last January, and before he passed away, it was hard for him to admit that he needed in his 90s to move from the house that he'd lived in for many years to an assisted living facility. And he wouldn't have had to move as fast as he did if he would have acknowledged that he didn't need to mow his grass with the precision that he felt like he had to mow his grass. Because, Bill, you would have been impressed by his grass, because he would mow it this way, and then he would come back and mow it this way. Perfect lines, every week. Blade sharpened. I think he probably sharpened the blade every week, too. And we kept saying, Clarence, if you would just mow it the way I mow mine. Oh, I can't do that. It wouldn't look right. Sometimes we're trying to make things look perfect when it really doesn't matter. half the year in North Dakota was covered with snow anyway, more than half the year. And are we keeping our eyes on Jesus? That's the most important question. Are we keeping our eyes on Jesus, or are we being so distracted by what's washing in around us? Are we keeping our eyes focused on Him? We closed last week with the song, I Lift My Hands, which we shared Louis Giglio's story of writing this song, of how he wrote this song at a point where he absolutely could not do anything. He was attacked by things he could not understand. And we're going to close with that song again today. Sometimes, in the trials that we face, all we can do is lift our hands and say, be still, there is a healer. His love is deeper than the sea. I can't figure this out right now. I can't make sense of it on my own. But I lift my hands to believe again. And I don't know where you're at this morning. Some of you may be in this room saying, Pastor, I'm just buried right now. And some of you may not be there, and it's okay if you're not there. I'm not trying to make you feel like you need to be. But I'm acknowledging that a lot of us are feeling buried, feeling overwhelmed. Let's keep our eyes on Jesus, no matter what we're facing, no matter how overwhelming things may seem right now, and lift our hands to believe again. Let's stand as we close.
Let faith arise. Father, may it be said of us that in the midst of the trials that we face, that we kept our eyes on you, that we didn't compromise who you had called us to be, that we were true and genuine in our faith, but we kept our eyes on you. And though we may feel pressed in on every side, we were not crushed. Though we may feel hunted down, we were not abandoned. May it be said of us that we fixed our eyes on you and on what was eternal. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. And you are dismissed.